That concludes general questions. We will now move on to the next item of business, which is First Minister's questions. And at question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. An email revealed yesterday at the UK COVID inquiry included, really, SNP members are groaning because we're asking about the COVID inquiry. So let me start again. Thank you, Presiding Officer. An email revealed yesterday by the UK COVID inquiry included senior SNP government figures discussing the travel ban to Spain in July 2020. The email says, "I am extremely concerned about this. It won't matter how much ministers might justify it on health grounds, the Spanish government will conclude it is entirely political. They won't forget. There is a real possibility they will never approve EU membership for an independent Scotland as a result." This wasn't a low-level consideration. The people included in this discussion were Nicola Sturgeon, absent again from Parliament. John Swinney, absent again from Parliament. Jean Freeman and Hamza Youssef. So, First Minister, why was independence even considered in a decision about public health?
First Minister.
Of course, it wasn't, Presiding Officer. And Douglas Ross, when he says this email came from a senior SNP official, it was from a Scottish Government civil servant, not from John Swinney, nor Nicola Sturgeon, nor from myself, or indeed from Jean Freeman. To suggest the decision around Spain was made for any other reason than epidemiology, I'm afraid, is an absolute fantasy. And even if we accepted Douglas Ross's example, or Douglas Ross's framing of the situation, that we were looking at this through a constitutional lens and attempting to curry favour with Spain, then surely then we would have put them on the exempt list. We didn't put them on the exempt list, is the exact point. And why did we not do that? Because let's look at the epidemiology at that point. That Scotland did not include Spain on the exempt list like England and Wales did. Why? Because their point of prevalence at that time was 0.33. That was four times higher than the point of prevalence in Scotland. So that was, in fact, Spain was the only country at that point proposed for the exempt list that had significantly higher prevalence for higher prevalence than Scotland did at the time. When I look at the evidence and the advice from the chief medical officer at the time, he expressed concern about the importation risks. So ministers concluded that they should not add Spain to the list of exempted countries due to our lower prevalence and the fact that Spain had four times higher prevalence, Presiding Officer. So Douglas Ross can do his best to spin. He can do his best to throw insults. He can do
his best to try to malign
and misrepresent facts and malign not just ministers but civil servants. But I believe the people of Scotland know, well, for all of the challenges that we had during the pandemic, that the Scottish Government always, always prioritised protecting the public from the harms of COVID. I don't think Douglas Ross can say the same of his party in the UK Government.
Douglas Ross. Thank you.
Amid pretty stiff competition, that might be the most bizarre answer I've ever heard from Hamza Youssef. He's saying it's fact. So here is a fact. The day after Hamza Youssef received that email speaking about political concerns that there might be with the Spanish government allowing an independent Scotland into the EU, he stood up and announced that they were introducing a corridor, travel corridor, with Spain. The very next day, they opened up travel to Spain, and 5 days later, they had to close it down again because COVID cases were rocketing. That's a fact, and we know it because Hamza Youssef told us. And it's black and white in evidence to the inquiry that they were thinking about independence instead of focusing purely on public health. Now, what we've not seen is any evidence of Hamza Youssef's response to that email. And Nicola Sturgeon's messages have all gone from that time because she deleted them. The former SNP leader destroyed all of her WhatsApp messages despite knowing that a do not destroy order was in place, despite promising grieving families she would be transparent, despite assuring journalists that all her messages would be handed to the inquiry. She told the press unequivocally, yes, her messages would be provided. So why did Nicola Sturgeon say yes when she actually meant no?
First Minister.
First of all, can I say once again, effective from 10th of July 2020, Spain was not included on the first exempt countries list due to the higher prevalence it had, higher, four times higher than it had in relation to Scotland. Let me just say, in relation to WhatsApp messages, Douglas Ross has thrown all sorts of incendiary accusations the way, particularly of Nicola Sturgeon for not retaining WhatsApp messages. He's demanded investigations and reviews. But not only did his boss, the Prime Minister, not retain his messages, he actually took the inquiry to court and lost. But just over the last hour, we've heard from Alistair Jack, again, Douglas Ross's boss when he was in the Scotland office. And what did Alistair Jack say about his WhatsApp messages? He was asked, did he delete his WhatsApp messages? And here's what Alistair Jack said. He says, I did delete them, and he deleted them because he wanted to free up storage capacity on his phone. When he was asked if there was any government business on these WhatsApps, he said, and I will quote him directly, I didn't think anything of it. When he was asked if he considered the needs of the public
Mr.
inquiry,
Salmar.
Here's what he said, and I will quote directly, no, I didn't. I was quite keen for my phone to start working again, is what he said, presiding officer.
Wow.
So it is astonishing that Douglas Ross demands investigations and reviews in relation to Nicola Sturgeon for not retaining her WhatsApps. But his boss, his colleague, who deletes his WhatsApps, didn't even think about the inquiry. Well, that's perfectly fine. Well, there's one word for that, presiding officer, and it's hypocrisy, and the people of Scotland can see right through Douglas Ross.
Douglas Ross.
It is not perfectly fine. Alistair Jack was wrong to delete his WhatsApp messages. He has apologised and he regrets it. Hamza Yousaf can't step out of the shadow of his disgraced predecessor and say the same. And of course, Nicola Sturgeon has not apologised. She has not apologised for doing it. She has said she was right because she was following government policy. That's a massive difference, First Minister. But I can't let the First Minister's confusion over this travel ban with Spain pass. He's just saying that they kept in place the restrictions with Spain. On the 20th of July, the day after that email was sent, Hamza Yousaf said, and I quote, we are able to lift the requirement for those travelling from Spain. 5 days later, he says the decision to exempt Spain earlier this week was taken when the data showed there was an improvement. The latest data has given us cause for concern to overturn that decision. So he definitely made a decision on the back of that
Mr.
email.
Mr. Ross, can I just ask the front bench to please resist any temptation to contribute? Mr. Ross.
Well, I think they're trying to come up with a story here because what the First Minister has said so far does not match what he did in practice in 2020. But we know that the deleted WhatsApp messages were covering up major decisions from this SNP government. We know that because of the messages we have been able to see. Hamza Yousaf, when he was then Health Secretary in charge of the NHS, joked with the National Clinical Director, Jason Leach. They laughed about false claims that children were hospitalised because of COVID. And in one revealing exchange, Hamza Yousaf said this, I'm winging it and we'll get found out sooner or later. First Minister, at what point do you think you were finally found out?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, let's again look at the facts. Where Douglas Ross is right, of course, there was Spain initially not exempt from a travel corridor and then put on a travel corridor. Why were they? Because we have the data that the UK government presented by the London
First
School
Minister,
of Hygiene.
First Minister, do you know we have so many members who want to put questions to the First Minister. That would be more likely if we could get on with our session and if I don't have to keep asking front benches to resist the temptation to contribute when they shouldn't be. First Minister.
Well, they don't want to listen to the facts, and the facts are this. That Douglas Ross, of course, said in his own response that the situation improved in Spain. And that is correct. The London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine showed a marked improvement in the position in Spain, with point prevalence going down to 0.015%. And that is the reason, of course, why they were then put on the exempt list. When the situation worsened, just a matter of days later, actually, worsened considerably, all of the UK nations decided to take them off that exempt list. So again, we made the decisions for purely epidemiological reasons. And when it comes to the UK government and the messages that we have seen, can I remind Douglas Ross of what we've seen from the UK government and the messages that have been revealed? He had a Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, that Douglas Ross not only backed to the very end, invited to his party conference. Boris Johnson, who allegedly, according to the evidence we've heard, said, let the bodies pile up high. When discussing long COVID, he called it, and forgive me, presiding officer, for the language, bollocks. We had a Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, who partied in number 10 while loved ones missed the funerals of their relatives. So yes, we could have done better when it came to the retention of informal messages. But when it comes to steering this country through some of its darkest days, I'm very pleased we had Nicola Sturgeon in charge here in the Scottish Government, as opposed to Boris Johnson.
I would remind all members of the need for courtesy, and members, I would be grateful if you could desist for a moment. Just let's remind one another of the need for courtesy and respect in this chamber, and that applies to using quotations to use words that might otherwise be regarded as unparliamentary. I'm also very conscious, as I've said, of the numbers who wish to put questions today, and I would be grateful for more concise questions and responses. And I call Douglas Ross.
Even after yesterday's evidence from the former First Minister, the words we've heard from the COVID-bereaved Hamza Yousaf still backs her to the hilt. And that tells you everything you need to know about this First Minister, who is simply the continuity candidate for Team Sturgeon. But as Health Secretary during the pandemic, he joked about not knowing what he was doing. When he sent that message, by that stage, 10,000 people in Scotland had already lost their lives from COVID. But he wasn't the only one that's been found out. Nicola Sturgeon destroyed evidence on an industrial scale. The SNP government considered independence for key decisions. They did things for purely political reasons. They broke promises to grieving families and the public who sacrificed so much. Hamza Yousaf was winging it, but hasn't the whole SNP government been found out?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I go back to the point that I've made several times in these exchanges over the weeks, that I absolutely accept wholeheartedly that a retention policy and informal communications clearly could have and should have been better. That's why, of course, I've commissioned that externally led review. But on the big calls, many of the decisions that we made helped to save lives. If we look at some of the evidence that's been presented to the COVID inquiry, if we look at the evidence from Professor Sir Ian Diamond, and Jackie Bailey shouting she may want to listen actually to the evidence by Professor Sir Ian Diamond. He's the chief executive of the UK Stats Authority and UK National Statistician. He gave details of age standardised mortality rates per 100,000 right across the four nations. This is his data, not my data. And that analysis shows that in Scotland, of course, we had the lowest level of deaths per 100,000, according to the ASMR data. Now, every single one of those lives lost is undoubtedly a tragedy. In fact, many of my colleagues on these benches lost a loved one to COVID. But on those calls, the decisions we made have helped to save lives. Let's look at what the World Health Organization said. And again, not my data, the World Health Organization's data. They estimated that 22,138,000 lives in Scotland were saved as a direct result of the COVID-19 vaccination programme. So I accept fully that when it comes to informal communications, we could have and should have done better. There are also other decisions which, of course, we look at and we think we could have perhaps moved quicker or moved earlier or done things differently. So while political opponents may well try to rewrite history and engage in, frankly, smears, insults
briefly, please, First
towards
Minister.
Government ministers and civil servants, yeah. I can stand up here and say that I know that every single day of that pandemic, Nicola Sturgeon, the rest of us in the Scottish Government, civil servants included, worked for one reason and one reason only, to protect the people of Scotland from the harms of COVID.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, this is what we've learned after 3 weeks of the COVID inquiry in Scotland. The most senior ministers and officials knowingly deleted evidence to how they operated during the pandemic. They subverted the COVID inquiry and broke freedom of information laws. They plotted how to maximise their own political advantage while thousands of Scots fought for their lives. It is a betrayal of the trust the people of Scotland put into this SNP government. Nicola Sturgeon didn't tell the truth to the public, and Humza Yousaf seems to have misled this parliament in an attempt to defend her. And now the SNP deputy leader is supporting attacks on the inquiry itself. Why is protecting the SNP more important to Humza Yousaf than getting to the truth?
First Minister.
It's simply a complete and utter mischaracterisation of what we have heard. On every occasion that I have had exchanges on this issue, I first of all once again acknowledged the impact of the decisions that we made around informal communications on the Scottish COVID bereaved. I do that again, and I apologise once again, unreservedly, as I did in the inquiry and to them directly, to those who are representing the Scottish COVID bereaved, for our mishandling in relation to the informal communications. We could have and should have done better. But I go back to the point that I just made to Douglas Ross, and I repeat it again to Anna Sawar. Yes, we should have done better on retention policy of informal communications. But in the course of this pandemic, when it came to the important decisions that helped to save lives, I believe we took, first of all, the decisions for the right reason. And I think we can evidence that very clearly, that the harms and the protecting people from harms and the people of Scotland from harm was the number one overriding priority. But through the actions that we took, when it came to one measure, and I conclude it is only and accept it's only one measure, the age standardised mortality rates per 100,000 across the four UK nations, Scotland had 124.9 per 100,000. That was different to England, 145 per 100,000, Wales 144 per 100,000, the UK average 143 per 100,000. That is not to diminish the number of lives that continue to be lost to COVID to this very day. And the decisions that we took, of course, also ensured that when it came to the booster vaccination, it was one of the fastest booster vaccination programmes in the world at one point, certainly the fastest in the UK by quite some distance too. So yes, we could have and should have done better. I accept fully on message retention. I, of course, handed over the messages that I had and questioned for them about them for almost 3 hours. But on the big calls that helped to save lives, I believe we can evidence, and we've seen the evidence, that not only did we do it for the right reason, but our interventions helped to save lives here in Scotland.
Anna Sarwar.
Presiding officer, ministers and officials knowingly deleted evidence for the COVID inquiry, and the answer to this betrayal of the Scottish people, a review into how the Scottish Government records information. In 2020, when we had the Salmond inquiry and there were accusations of a cover-up, what did they do? Promise a review. In 2022, when we had investigations into the ferry scandal and there were accusations of a cover-up, what did they do? Promise a review. And now we have the industrial-scale deletion of evidence for the COVID inquiry. And what's this First Minister's answer? A review. They simply don't get it. Pamela Thomas, who lost her brother during the pandemic, said this yesterday. I don't think they're capable of actually telling the truth or being transparent. Pamela's right, isn't she?
First Minister.
I want to, of course, express my condolence to every single member of the country who lost a loved one through COVID, Pamela, of course, included. And I make this point again to Anna Sawar, that all of us, including, of course, members of this government, also lost loved ones to COVID. And ministerial colleagues who have relatives who continue to suffer the long-term effects of COVID. I have colleagues who had to, of course, restrict the numbers who could attend the funeral of a loved one. Many of us, myself included, had children who were impacted because of the closure of schools, because of COVID. And I say that not because I'm trying to garner any sympathy from Anna Sawar or anybody else. I say that because we were all in this together. We were not detached somehow from the impacts or the effects of the pandemic. And that's why every decision we made was made with one overarching priority in mind: how to protect as many people as we could from the harm of COVID. Do I think we got every decision right? No, I don't. I don't think any government in the world, any government leader in the world, could put their hand in their heart and say they got every single decision right. What I can say is we did it for the right reasons. And on the big decisions that were crucial to saving lives, I believe on many of them, we got them right. Some, of course, will not have got right. And I promise those who have been bereaved by COVID, the families of those who have been bereaved by COVID, that not only will we continue to cooperate with both inquiries, but we promise to learn the lessons of those inquiries too.
Anna Sarwar.
The COVID bereaved families don't believe the First Minister when he gives those reassurances. The COVID inquiry is about learning the lessons so this can never happen again. But they have been obstructed by this government, with evidence supplied late or not at all. The decisions the inquiry is investigating still weigh on the people across this country. Why were COVID-positive patients sent into care homes? Why was inadequate PPE being supplied to care workers and leaving people exposed? What impact did lockdowns have on our young people who missed out on years of education? 3 years ago, in an election during the pandemic, many people in Scotland voted for his party because they thought Nicola Sturgeon did the best she could. They trusted her when she said this Parliament would be about COVID recovery. Now those same people have had their trust broken by this government and they're appalled at the cover-up. First Minister, isn't it true? It's not just the messages that have disappeared. So has the trust in this SNP government.
First Minister.
I tend to leave the verdict of trust to the people of Scotland. Anna Sarwar is right. One of the major factors of why the SNP is back into power is because of our handling over the course of the pandemic. And that wasn't judged. Anna Sarwar's shouting, wow, I'm saying to Anna that he's absolutely correct and one of the reasons why we're standing here. What I don't think was an issue during the 2021 election was our retention policy, our record management policy. It was whether or not we got the calls right in relation to the vaccination programme. It's whether, of course, we did the right thing in terms of introducing non-pharmaceutical interventions. Anna Sarwar talks about, in his words, an industrial scale deletion. We handed over 28,000 WhatsApp messages and 19,000 documents. Anna Sarwar is right to ask questions about care homes, around PPE, about lockdown and its impacts. These are exactly the questions the inquiry is examining. And this suggestion from Anna Sarwar that somehow we're not being transparent, can I remind Anna Sarwar that not only are we cooperating with a UK inquiry, we're the only nation in the UK to specifically establish an inquiry in our country. And we'll also be cooperating with that Scottish inquiry too. Nicola Sturgeon, over 250 media briefings. Ministers in this government attended this parliament, not on dozens of occasions, but hundreds of occasions explaining the reason why we took decisions. And presiding officer, I go back to the very central point here. We didn't get everything right, and certainly not in relation to retention of messages. What we did get right and what we did do is the intention behind our decisions was to protect people from harm. And what we did, according to the World Health Organisations, through the interventions we took, helped to save over 23,000 people's lives. Those are 23,000 people that would not be here if it was not for vaccinations, if it was not for the non-pharmaceutical interventions and the decisions that this government took. And I make no apologies for that.
Question number three, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
Tuesday.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, we did hear striking testimony from the former First Minister at the inquiry yesterday about a personal phone on which she retained WhatsApp messages for the Salmond inquiry, but deleted them for every aspect of the pandemic, forever denying the bereaved families an insight into the mind of the person who held all of the power. About hospitality rules, seemingly made up at random, sending some businesses to the wall, unanswered questions about care homes, about school closures, and a secret central committee in charge, it seems, of everything, about which the finance secretary knew nothing and of which there are no minutes. A government within a government. Humza Yousaf saw all of this and yet did nothing. So why is he now standing in the way of a ministerial code investigation into Gold Command record keeping, something only he can instruct? And does he agree that Nicola Sturgeon now has a duty to come back to this chamber? This chamber, he says, she addressed hundreds of times and once more, finally, explain herself.
First Minister.
Can I say, of course, Nicola Sturgeon gave hours of testimony and evidence and under oath, of course, and was questioned extensively. It will be for now the inquiry to make its judgment, and we respect the inquiry and, of course, hope that others will respect the inquiry and give it the time and space it needs to make its judgment. I'm not sure what Anna Sarwar and others are shouting at. I'm simply saying the inquiry should be respected. So can I say that Nicola Sturgeon or this government got every decision right?
First Minister, sorry. I'm actually being distracted by a conversation that is going on across the aisles. Can I ask members to refrain from such contributions while we're trying to hear the First Minister?
Well, I think the opposition should try to respect the inquiry, and that is the point I am making. And I can say without a shadow of a doubt, as I've already said before, that our overarching, overriding priority was always to protect the people of Scotland from COVID harm. And Nicola Sturgeon's leadership was in stark contrast to leadership we saw in other parts of the United Kingdom. And she may not have got every decision right. This government may not have got every decision right. I accept that fully. But it's for the inquiry to examine and to explore that issue. On Gold Command meeting minutes that Alex Cole-Hamilton has asked me about, yes, the government is urgently examining, exploring, and will hand over to the inquiry any notes that we have on Gold Command minutes and meetings.
Question number four, Stephanie Callaghan.
Presiding officer, to ask the First Minister what steps the Scottish Government has taken to prevent a resurgence of measles in Scotland.
First Minister.
Cases of measles in Europe and England continue to rise due to under-vaccination. While we've only seen two laboratory-confirmed cases of measles to date in Scotland since October, but we are acting now to prevent the spread and to protect people. Public Health Scotland has alerted NHS Scotland. It's also met local health protection teams and immunisation coordinators to set out measures that need to be taken. These include early detection and notification, infection control, contact tracing, post-exposure prophylaxis for vulnerable contacts to try to ensure that the cases are contained and don't spread any further. Immunisation, of course, remains the most effective way of preventing illness from infectious disease, and the MMR vaccine is extremely effective at preventing measles. Anyone who hasn't had both doses of the free MMR vaccine should visit the NHS Inform website and find out how to arrange an appointment.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. And while Scotland's uptake of childhood immunisations has continued to perform really well across the four UK nations, there is recent data from Public Health Scotland that highlights the gradual decline, with overall uptake of both doses falling below the World Health Organisation's target of 90%, a critical level that protects against the return of large outbreaks. So can I ask the First Minister what steps the Scottish Government has taken to highlight the importance of receiving both doses of MMR vaccine, and can he outline what strategies are in place to ensure easy access to follow-up appointments for children in cases where vaccinations, one or both doses, have been missed?
First Minister.
Given the very serious nature of measles and the current risk of importation and onward transmission, we are working with Public Health Scotland and also NHS boards on a whole range of measures promoting vaccination uptake. NHS Inform has been updated, ensuring information is available for the public on how they can receive the measles vaccination. Letters were issued to parents of pupils for nursery schools, P1 primary schools, and S1 secondary schools too, highlighting the importance of ensuring that young people are up to date with their vaccinations. Boards have also been requested to undertake an MMR status check of all pupils in S1. This check was previously performed in S3, but bringing forward these checks to S1 provides more opportunities for those unvaccinated or indeed under-vaccinated to obtain the vaccination they require.
Brief supplementary, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and I'm very grateful for the previous answer from the First Minister, because work has undergone in our universities to make sure that the measles vaccinations have been up to date, and he's talked about the work at S1. Can he give any specific initiatives that are aimed at increasing the awareness specifically to parents, guardians and indeed teachers about the importance of maintaining the up-to-date measles vaccination by having the two doses?
First Minister.
Well, thank Martin Whitfield for a very important question indeed, and he is right to obviously reference higher education as well. I will ask the Cabinet Secretary for Health to write to Martin Whitfield with full detail of what we have done, including, of course, that we've issued letters to parents, for example, in the 23-24 intake of pupils for nursery schools, as well as other pupils as well. We've also sent a variety of letters from the CMO, from the Chief Medical Officer, to health professionals as well to make sure in their interactions, often in primary care, with parents and families around the importance of the vaccination. But I will ensure the Cabinet Secretary for Health writes to Martin Whitfield with more details about the actions that we have taken in this regard.
Brief supplementary, Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The worryingly low uptake both of the MMR and the flu vaccine in the Highlands increases the risk to public health and of an outbreak of measles. Therefore, will the First Minister and his Cabinet Secretary for Health ask the NHS Highland to work with GP practices such as that in Nairn, who are very keen to resume local provision from GP practices of this service in order to bring up the vaccination levels to safe amounts? And, First Minister, an approach that I believe is favoured by the British Medical Association.
First Minister.
Thanks, Ewing is right to raise this issue around the particularly lower levels of vaccination in Highland that are concerning. I want to give him some reassurance that engagement with the Health Board is already happening. I know that Fergus Ewing has raised this issue before. He's raised it with me in relation to COVID vaccinations as well, but I am worried about the levels of vaccination in Highland. We are taking up that engagement with the NHS Board, and we will ask the direct question for those GP practices that do want to resume what the barrier is, and we will examine whether or not the lower uptake in vaccination in Highlands is a result of the different, as a result, forgive me, of the model that is in place there, and I'll ensure that Fergus Ewing is kept up to date in relation to those discussions.
Question number five, Graham Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to reports that Scottish Water plans to increase charges by 29% over 3 years.
First Minister.
Well, let me start by clarifying the arrangements for setting water charges. They're set out in the Water Industry Scotland Act 2022, and decisions on charges are rightly a matter for the Board of Scottish Water. They'll announce their charges for 24-25 shortly. Charges for future years have not yet been agreed. They will be set annually by Scottish Water's Board with approval from the independent economic regulator in line with the price cap across the 21-27 period. In 23-24, the average charge in England and Wales is 10% higher than in Scotland, £448 compared to a charge in Scotland of £408.
Graham Simpson.
Well, I'm not interested in what's going on in England and Wales.
Let's hear Mr. Simpson.
Scottish Water are reported to want to increase bills by 8.8% in 24-25 and then do the same every year until 26-27. Now, that might be all right for their new chief exec, Alex Plant, who can well afford it on his £295,000 a year salary, but that's not okay for normal people struggling to pay their bills. Now, water bills are paid through our council tax, Presiding Officer, and given that the First Minister has committed to freeze council tax, is he not prepared to do the same with water?
First Minister.
Well, the brass neck of a Conservative talking about the impact on people's household bills is quite something to witness, Presiding Officer. So let me talk about Scotland and Scottish Water. I've already said, of course, that the charges haven't been announced, will be announced shortly, and they will be, of course, reviewed and announced annually. But, of course, with Scottish Water, what we end up getting in comparison to England and Wales is better levels of service. We get lower water charges here in Scotland in comparison to England. We get a publicly owned water company with every single penny of profit reinvested back into the public service. Unlike in England, where his party is in charge, where shareholders get millions and dividends. We get water quality that's 87% good or at a high level, as assessed by SEPA. As in so many issues, the Conservative UK government do far better at looking at how we run Scottish Water and indeed our public services for the good of the people of Scotland. And it seems while the UK government run their services into the ground, they do so for the profit of shareholders, unlike Scottish Water, which is publicly owned, Presiding Officer.
Question number six, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the First Minister when the Scottish Government expects the remainder of the national treatment centres to be opened in light of reports that NHS capital infrastructure projects have been paused.
First Minister.
The next two national treatment centres, NTC Forth Valley and also Phase 2 of the Golden Jubilee, they're due to open in the coming months, providing additional orthopaedic, endoscopy and general surgery capacity. Our ability to fund capital projects has, of course, been detrimentally impacted and affected by twin challenges of unprecedented levels of inflation caused in some part by Brexit and disastrous UK government decisions, but also, of course, one of those disastrous UK government decisions being the cut in our capital budget. So our infrastructure investment plan identified priority health capital projects, including national treatment centres, for funding within that period. As a result of the almost 10% cut in our capital budget from the UK government, a revised pipeline of infrastructure investment will be published in the spring of this year. All due consideration will be given to what projects can be included and in what timescales, and of course that would include national treatment centres too.
Jackie Bailey. Can I thank the First Minister for his response? But he knows that national treatment centres are key to the SNP's NHS recovery plan. We now learn that these promises to patients and staff are in tatters. Treatment centres in Ayrshire and Arran, Lanarkshire, Lothian, Grampian and Tayside, all delayed and at risk of cancellation. But these treatment centres aren't the only NHS capital infrastructure projects put at risk. Aberdeen Bed Family Hospital and Anchor Centre, delayed. Institute of Neurosciences in Glasgow, delayed. Monklands Replacement Project in Lanarkshire, delayed. Edinburgh Cancer Centre, the Eye Pavilion, delayed. Caithness, Ragmore, the Belford, delayed. Health centres in Kincardine, Loughgelly and East Calder, cancelled. Barra Community Campus, cancelled. Presiding Officer, I could go on, but can I ask the First Minister, with almost one in six Scots on waiting lists, how is he going to end their suffering when these developments were so central to his plan?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, as always, Jackie Bailey will come to this chamber ignoring the fiscal reality and effectively act as a human shield for the Conservatives, who are cutting our capital budget by 10%. The fact that Jackie Bailey thinks a 10% cut can be imposed upon us with no consequences shatters any credibility she has on this issue, Presiding Officer. We have, of course, made a dent into waiting times in terms of improvements that we are looking to make. So new, when it comes to activity in the NHS, new outpatient activity was up on the last quarter and up 2.3% on Q3 last year. Over the last 12 months to September 23, activity was almost 1.24 million. That's 2.5% more than the previous 12 months. And when I look at inpatient day case activity for Q3, that was at its highest since the start of the pandemic. So we are doing what we can, notwithstanding the financial constraints and the cuts we're receiving from the UK government. So we'll continue to invest in that capacity. And I should say to Jackie Bailey, of course, it would be very helpful if Jackie Bailey could use any influence she has with her UK Labour colleagues, who have thus far refused to confirm that they will reverse that capital cut, Presiding Officer.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last year, 59,240 patients attended the Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion. For a patient in Edinburgh or the Borders with a detached retina, the need for urgent emergency surgery is critical. The Health Secretary has suggested that if the Edinburgh Eye Pavilion is not replaced, then more surgery will be centralised to the Golden Jubilee National Hospital in Glasgow. Can I ask the First Minister if he thinks it would be acceptable for eye surgery to be centralised to Glasgow, and will he agree to meet with Lothian MSPs urgently to discuss these concerns and look towards where ministers can change their mind and commit to a new replacement eye hospital?
First Minister.
Can I say to Miles Briggs, of course, the clue is in the name. They are national treatment centres that we are building, so where they can offer assistance right across the country, they should be utilised in that way. And we know that, of course, patients are, if necessary, willing to travel. But our commitment to the Eye Pavilion remains, and that's why we'll bring forward, of course, detail on what we can take forward in regards to our investment plans. But, of course, I'm more than happy to assure that the Cabinet Secretary for Health meets with Miles Briggs. What would be more helpful for Miles Briggs to do is demand that his UK Government Conservative colleagues reverse their 10% cut to our capital budget. They could do that in the spring budget next month. Let's see if Miles Briggs and the Scottish Conservatives, who come to this chamber demanding money be spent on capital projects, have any influence. Somehow, Presiding Officer, I think not.
Kate Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Plans for a new Belford hospital have made great progress in recent years with Scottish Government support, and it's deeply unfortunate that the 10% UK Government cut to capital has postponed the actual build. But can the First Minister commit to enabling the design process to progress so that it is shovel-ready when capital does become available to allow the start of the actual build?
First Minister.
We are absolutely engaged on that very issue at the moment. I think the suggestion from Kate Forbes is a sensible approach forward, and we'll certainly seek to do that. I think it's essential that NHS boards continue to plan on how they will improve and reform services, and we remain committed to absolutely supporting boards in that process. But this, of course, goes back to the point that there are many capital projects right across the country that are under threat, not because of anything that this government has done, but because of the disastrous mismanagement of the economy from the UK government and a 10% capital cut, which is not just going to impact on health projects, but on capital projects right across the country. We appeal once again to the UK government to use the spring budget next month to reverse that devastating cut to allow these important health capital projects to go ahead, Presiding Officer.
Move to constituency general supplementaries, and I call Finlay Carson.
To ask the First Minister if he will join with me in welcoming the very positive progress that has been made in negotiations which are likely to see the restoration of the Northern Ireland Assembly at Stormont, and also welcome the huge job and investment boost which could be delivered as part of the proposed investment zone extending to Stranraer and Cairnryan in my constituency, which is the main point of entry for Northern Ireland goods going to Great Britain along the A75 and the A77.
First Minister.
I absolutely welcome the restoration, or I hope the restoration of power sharing in Northern Ireland. The people of Northern Ireland have had for too long to have to put up without an elected government in place. So this is good news for the people of Northern Ireland, and we welcome it absolutely wholeheartedly. I've been to a number of British Irish councils over the years in my time as First Minister, and in the last couple that I've been as First Minister, the absence of the Northern of any elected members from Northern Ireland has been noted, and their presence has been missed. So I think it's incredibly important as part of the Good Friday Agreement that we have power sharing restored. It would be fair to say that we weren't given any advance sight of the command paper that was published by the UK government yesterday. There was no meaningful engagement by the Westminster government. The UK government appears to unilaterally have decided that there will be no border control post Cairnryan. It's not a decision that they have consulted us on. I also note that there was a £3.3 billion package offered to the Secretary of State, offered by the Secretary of State, to address public spending and for pay pressures in Northern Ireland, which I have to say again is welcome. These pressures do exist in Scotland, and I suspect they exist in Wales too. So I know that the Deputy First Minister has raised with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, as did her Welsh counterpart, that devolved government should be treated fairly in line with the Barnett formula.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mark Scott was murdered in 1995 as he walked through Brigton on his way back from a Celtic game. The murder was a brutal, unprovoked, sectarian attack. But from this tragic murder came hope in the form of the Mark Scott Leadership for Life Award, which is now delivered by the Outward Bound Trust and brings young people together to share experiences and reduce racism, sectarianism and intolerance. The Scottish Government has provided core funding since 2012, which has allowed the awards to leverage other funding in from alternative sources. That amount stands at £75,000, and the Trust have been told that it will be removed from next year. Surely the First Minister agrees with me that this life-changing award for young people that tackles sectarianism in the best way I can think of cannot be allowed to fail due to government cuts. And given that I'm meeting with the Trust today, will he engage with me to find a solution to reinstate the funding?
First Minister.
Can I say to Paul O'Kane, he raises a very important point indeed. I know the work that Mark Scott Foundation has done over the years alongside the Outward Bound Trust as well. I've met some of those who have taken part in the project. I think they have done incredibly well as an organisation. I think they have had a really positive impact on young people as well. It's an organisation I've engaged with over many, many years indeed, and I can confirm to Paul O'Kane to this chamber that the Mark Scott Foundation will receive £75,000. We will ensure that they are funded fully in order to carry on the excellent work that the Leadership Award has done over many, many years. And that work, of course, I think is a lasting legacy and testimony to Mark Scott and, of course, his family too.
Co-Cap Stewart.
Presiding Officer, this week Liz Smith endorsed the reintroduction of backdoor tuition fees, which would deny disadvantaged students from going to university. It follows Labour leader Keir Starmer ruling out free tuition fees under a UK Labour government. Can the First Minister outline what progress the SNP Scottish Government has made in widening access, and will he reaffirm his commitment to keeping tuition fees free?
First Minister.
Hardly a surprise to hear the Conservatives heckling when we mention free education. I have to say, Presiding Officer, I was absolutely delighted
to see the First Minister's progress
that we have made in this regard, highlighted by the Commissioner of Fair Access this week. A 45% increase in students from our most deprived communities entering university since 2013-2014. No wonder the Conservatives were groaning. They don't like it, Presiding Officer, one single bit. The Commissioner also points out that this increase has not been at the expense of other cohorts of Scottish students, with increases in home students right across the board. So unlike Labour and the Conservatives, we are absolutely committed to the principle that access to education should be based on the ability to learn, never on the ability to pay, Presiding Officer.
And Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mums and babies across Scotland are missing out on vital health visitor appointments. And I know this because it happened to me, as my daughter was not seen for over 10 months. Parents in Angus have been told that their babies could be without a visit for up to a year. Health visitors are important because they check on a child's well-being, but can also identify if mums are experiencing postnatal depression. The First Minister and the Health Secretary cannot bury their heads in the sand over this issue. So will the First Minister intervene urgently to ensure mums and babies are not denied these crucial visits because of staff shortages?
First Minister.
Because Megan Gallagher is absolutely right about the importance of health visitors for a range of reasons that I think she has articulated very, very well. Indeed, health visiting remains a universal service. Teams across Scotland work hard to deliver this entitlement, and the latest published data that we have shows that the overwhelming vast majority of eligible children are receiving their key health visitor contacts between 10 days and 5 years of age. That's not to say that there are not challenges, and I am more than happy for the Health Secretary to write to Megan Gallagher, giving her the details of what we're doing to invest in the service, but also what we're doing, particularly in those areas where we are seeing disparities, what we are doing to further support health visiting services. But I want to put on record my thanks to every single health visitor for the incredible work that they do.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is Members' business debate in the name of Kenneth Gibson, and there'll now be a short suspension to allow those leaving the chamber and public gallery to do so.